Yesterday we had an order arrive for the biology department, which was delivered in a box of dry ice. Never the one to waste the opportunity to play, I thought it was about time that we talked about some of the simple yet mesmerizing demonstrations it lets you do. CO2 is solid, below minus 78 degrees Celsius, so skin contact should be avoided. I'm using an insulated glove here to pop a few pieces into this 500 centimeter cube PET bottle made for a carbonated beverage. I'm going to pop the stopper on and behind this safety screen. Dry ice is so named because under atmospheric pressure, it sublimes straight to the gas without passing through the liquid phase. A gas which at atmospheric pressure is going to take up about 800 times more volume than the pellets. So I'm hoping that this bung will pop off at some point during this video when I leave it behind this safety screen. The classic thing to do with dry ice is to drop it into water to which you've added some indicator. The changes in colours demonstrate how the resulting solution is acidic. Safe handling of dry ice reduces the risk of cold burns, asphyxiation, and explosions from the gas buildup. Thank you very much. Members should check the CLEAPS website for a special risk assessment, as it's unlikely to be covered by your model risk assessments. There is also guidance there for making ice cream with the dry ice, much of which is used in the UK by the food industry, but given what my dry ice was used to ship, I shan't be doing that with this batch. In a typical laboratory, you're unlikely to reach unsafe levels of CO2, even from a big box like this, but technicians should be aware because if it's stored in a small cupboard, then the risk would be much higher. Don't store it in a small contained space like a fridge or a freezer, certainly never in a sealed container like an ordinary unvented vacuum flask made for food. I'm working in a large, well-ventilated space here, and so the dry ice is in an expanded polystyrene box, and therefore the risks are going to be negligible. Due to the risk of cold burns, direct handling of the ice should be avoided. Thick gloves which offer thermal protection and are not made from rubber, and eye protection, of course, should be worn. You can use any large flask to demonstrate the effect. It scales very nicely. Here I've got a 250ml flask with a flat bottom, and I can actually add a little bit of 0.4 molar sodium hydroxide just to get a little bit of a color there. And once I grab a couple of pieces, into here, we get our classic effect. Warm water is going to produce more dramatic clouds and mist effects. To get a wider range of colors, you can of course add a base, just like I did before. I was using 0.4 molar sodium hydroxide because it was concentrated enough to delay the color change, but dilute enough that it's not corrosive. Finally, a large piece or a few smaller pieces of the dry ice will start the effect. Carbon dioxide at the surface of the pellet dissolves in, reacts with the water, producing carbonic acid, which itself reacts with the base added to the flask. Clearly, the exact color changes that you get are going to depend on your indicator makeup, but you're unlikely to see a change to red. In my pH 4 to 11 indicator, acetic acid will go bright red, but in terms of their Ka values, carbonic acid is about 40 times weaker than acetic acid, so my universal indicator tends to stay orange. The clouds puffing out of the top of the flask come from the condensation of water droplets inside the bubbles within the fluid, rather than due to contact with humid air. Tom Kunzelman demonstrated this by adding dry ice to an alcohol instead. Here I found a mixture of alcohols which were left over from other uses. Notice the lack of cloud formation in the case of the tube where we've got the alcohols instead of the water. The CO2 itself is denser than air, a property we exploited in February 2020's fire stopper demonstration. In June of 2011, Adrian Guy also exploited this by using hydrochloric acid to make a bath of CO2 through its reaction with calcium carbonate. Bubbles of air blown across the top of a tank with dry ice left in the bottom, such that you don't induce too much mixing, should find a point at which they float, and if they last long enough, take on CO2 through diffusion and begin to sink. What do you think would happen if I were to make up my solutions more carefully? Let's take a look at some samples of 0.1 molar sodium hydroxide and 0.1 molar ammonia. Which do you think will change color first and why? Will they both go green at the same time? When will the last color change take place? There are many other things that you can do with CO2, but always check with CLEEPS and don't deviate from the guidance in the special risk assessments there, as the internet is not short of videos of people taking unreasonable risks with this stuff, so do be smart, stay safe, and I'll see you in a couple of months.